welcome to Capitol Hill for 2012. By any measure, the federal government's had a less than stellar start to the year. In seeking to get the issue of poker machine reform off the agenda, it's also lost the support of independent Andrew Wilkie. A speech by the Transport Minister, Anthony Albanese, to set the scene for the year ran into trouble when he stole a scene from a Hollywood movie. And last week, a media adviser to the Prime Minister had to resign after he passed on to a union official the details of the whereabouts of Tony Abbott and Mr Abbott's comments about the Aboriginal tent embassy. Following that, there was a rowdy protest at the venue both Tony Abbott and the Prime Minister were at, and they had to be hustled out by their security team. Joining me for the first program of the year are Labor MP Michael Danby and Liberal MP Dennis Jensen. Welcome to you both.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you as well, Lyndall.
Michael, if I could start with you, are you completely satisfied that we've heard the full story about what happened with that protest on Australia Day last week?
My experience in politics teaches me the iron rule, always over a conspiracy choose a cock-up, and this is an almighty cock-up.
And an almighty cock-up in what sense? That it damaged the government, that it was the wrong thing to do, that it's diverted attention from the things the government wanted to be talking about?
Oh, all of the above. I don't think any of the individuals necessarily were involved in deliberately orchestrating it like that, but that's how it worked out. The government's extraordinarily unlucky that diversions like this obscure the fact that the Australian economy basically is in sound shape and much better shape than any economy in the world.
Does it raise questions about the judgment of the people in the Prime Minister's office, particularly Mr Hodges, who resigned, but also other people over how the matter has been subsequently dealt with?
Well, apparently Mr Hodges passed the information on accurately. I think the unionist in the ACT sounds to me like she told people at that Aboriginal embassy and inflamed the situation. I wish that it had never happened. The Prime Minister has made it very clear that she wanted to honour the emergency workers. She, in private recordings, behaved absolutely correctly with the Leader of the Opposition, and that's how people should really look at her character. This is was a cock-up, I think we should sort of go on and look at the big issues from there.
If we could, we'll listen now to what the Shadow Attorney General, George Brandis, has had to say today. He's referred the matter to the Federal Police. This is what he told a news conference.
We need to have explained to us why it was that there was a delay of some 24 hours before action was taken. The opposition regards this as a very serious matter. We are suspicious of a cover-up. We are more than suspicious that the public are not being given the full story.
The Prime Minister has made it clear that the period of time from when staff were advised to when she was advised was staff doing due diligence to make sure that they were absolutely sure of the facts before a report was given to her, and she has accepted that, firstly. Secondly, the Prime Minister has made the point that this was essentially one officer acting by himself. He's paid the consequences of making a very serious error of judgment. In terms of other officials, officers in the Prime Minister's office, I'm not going to name any of them, so this is not a response to the individual you've named. I'm old-fashioned. I take the view that staffers should be neither seen nor heard. We're the ones who front up. The Prime Minister's office is a professional office, and the dealings that I have with them are done on that basis.
Now, the Defence Minister, who we heard from there, has also pointed out that the Federal Police have said its examination of the information has found that there was no evidence of a criminal act. Dennis Jensen, George Brandis has referred the matter again to the Federal Police. While there may be political questions to ask, is it really a matter for the Federal Police?
Well, I think it is on a few regards. George Brandis clearly pointed to a few sections of both ACT criminal code and also Commonwealth criminal code that may have been breached. The fact that the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition were put in potentially a very dangerous situation is clearly cause for due diligence to be undertaken and an examination of the facts by the AFP. In terms of the Prime Minister's office, I mean, Minister Smith was saying, oh, it's a very professional office and so on. What's happened is you've had a member of that office acting alone or on instruction has actually gone and put both the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition in a potentially dangerous situation, and that is not the hallmark of a professional office at all. This is the hallmark of an office that is more concerned with spin than it is with substance. So I agree with Michael Danby. I've got a lot of respect for Michael. The facts that need to be looked at are policies regarding the economy and other issues. However, this is something that is serious and it does need to be dealt with accordingly.
Why does the opposition, though, not accept the statement from the Federal Police this morning that its examination of the issues raised do not warrant any or they found no evidence of a criminal act?
Well, the fact that the Shadow Attorney General has indicated sections of the various codes that may have been breached, and the simple fact that the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition were put in a position of potential significant danger. That is something that clearly needs examination in and of itself.
Michael, how does the government improve the year it's had so far? How does it get back to talking about the issues it wants to? Or is the danger that members of the government will continue to inflict wounds on themselves?
Well, the government's got a great story to tell. The Prime Minister's going to be here on Wednesday talking about the Australian economy. That's what the Treasurer was doing this morning on your Radio National. That's what we should be doing. We should be continuing to talk about the success of the Australian economy, great plans that Labor has for disability insurance, all of the programs that we've put through that have been a great success, riding off the back of the fact that Australia is a hugely successful and confident country. We've got all kinds of areas where we need to look into. We just had a poor fellow in my electorate who was homeless, murdered because there wasn't enough emergency accommodation. These are the kinds of things that Labor is focused on.
Dennis, is there any danger in raising the questions, as George Brandis has today, in focusing on the issue of things like the Australia Day protest and other problems that the government has had this year, that maybe the opposition might be seen by some too as not addressing the issues that people are concerned about?
Well, I think that we are addressing the issues that people are concerned about. I mean, issues such as significantly increasing power costs, which significantly impact on various industries. I mean, we are already starting to see the seeds of the impacts in things like the car industry, in things like the steel industry, where the government is putting additional subsidies into those industries. Partially in response to the additional impost that these industries will have with a carbon tax. I mean, now, particularly with a global economy being the way it is, with, you know, risks potentially of having a situation like you had in the 1930s, for us to be embarking on this grandiose carbon tax scheme.
If I could turn now...
That's not right, though. I mean, we legislated last year and the opposition voted against assistance to the steel industry. The assistance to BlueScope and OneSteel are just part of the sort of segments of the overall plan that we set out last year. In legislation, it's no secret.
But Michael, the point is the impacts of the carbon tax are in effect already being had ahead of time, and this is a carbon tax that the government promised not to introduce prior to the last election.
If I could turn now to Dennis' comments by one of your former colleagues, a former Howard government minister, Amanda Vanstone, who's criticised Mr Abbott for saying he wouldn't support a conscience vote on same-sex marriage, saying many Liberal MPs would have assumed there would be a conscience vote and that Mr Abbott waited until the troops were dispersed, until Parliament had risen for the year, not for a party meeting to announce he didn't want a conscience vote. While you may disagree with Amanda Vanstone, are these things better when they're decided by the party first?
Well, I mean, keeping away from, any personal issues that Amanda might have on this, the simple fact is that this has been party policy. It was party policy going into the 2010 election, the 2007 election, the 2004 election. It's very clearly understood that the coalition says that marriage is between a man and a woman, and it's been party policy all of those years. The difference is that Julia Gillard, prior to the last election, promised that the Labor Party had a party position as well of seeing marriage as being defined as being between a man and a woman. We are not the ones that have resiled from the position that we took going into the last election. That was coalition policy. It remains coalition policy. The Labor Party seems to be changing its mind again in going against one of their election promises.
Michael, it's not always the case that all policies are taken to the party room before they're announced, is it, on either side of politics?
No, that's true. But, I mean, the current leader of the opposition seems to have a propensity for pushing his own views on the party without consulting people. I mean, Dennis is a pretty feisty member of the Liberal Party. He's got sort of strong views on climate change. He had the sort of a bit sort of odd, I thought, view that, you know, we should put a huge space cloth in space to prevent global warming. He's going to stand up to Tony Abbott on these kind of issues. Look, we've learnt in the Labor Party from hard experience that sometimes it's better to question the leader rather than let these issues run. And it's for the good of the government, and I'm sure it's for the good of the opposition. But when you have a leader of the opposition who continually does things like announce that they're going to have maternity grants, that they're going to vote as a bloc on gay marriage without consultation with the party, I'm sure people like Dennis and others will start to feel the hot breath of what's going to happen by chance they get into government.
If I could ask both of you finally and quickly, because next week there'll be the first sitting of Parliament for the year. First to you, Dennis, are you happy with the way your party room's operating?
Yes, I am. And just to make a point on what Michael said a little bit earlier, the fact is with a coalition, we can make anything a conscience vote if we want to. We don't get thrown out of the party for crossing the floor. The difference with the Labor Party is that they have to follow the party line unless they're explicitly given a conscience vote.
Michael, there'll be a meeting of caucus on Sunday. Are you happy with the way your party room's operating?
I'm happy, much happier with the way the party room's operating. I wish we were being able to sell our policies a lot more clearly. And I think lots of us have got ideas. We're going to get up there with the butcher's paper and work with Julia on making sure that they're communicated to the electorate
and
a lot more clearly.
And that's where we'll have to leave it. Dennis Jensen and Michael Danby, thank you very much for joining us for the first Capitol Hill of 2012.
Thank you very much, Lyndall.
Thanks, Lyndall.
And that's where we'll leave it today. Thanks for your company.